الله ولي الذين آمنوا.
السلام على عباده الذين اصطفى. أما بعد، أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وذروا ظاهر الإثم وباطنه. وقال الله تعالى في مقام آخر: من يعمل سوءا يجز به. وقال الله تعالى في مقام آخر: يا أيها الناس إنما بغيكم على أنفسكم. وقال الله تعالى في مقام آخر: ولا يحيط المكر السيء إلا بأهله. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون. السلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وبارك وسلم. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وبارك وسلم. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وبارك وسلم. وذروا ظاهر الإثم وباطنة. The meaning of the verse of Quran that you should leave all the sins which you do openly or secretly. Sin means to do something against the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or against the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we have been ordered by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to refrain from all these sins. We do it openly, apparently, or we do it secretly. So it's a ruling. The example of the sin is just like the cancerous part of the body. So if someone has cancer in some part of the body, then the only solution is that he has to get it operated. If that part will not be operated, then the cancer will spread and eventually the person will die. Similarly, a person who commits sin, if he does not leave the sin, then this habit will become more and more stronger and this person will spiritually die one day. In the beginning, the example of the sin is just like a piece of thread. You can just break the piece of thread anytime you like it. But with the passage of time, the example of sin becomes just like the anchor of the ship. You know, every ship has anchor. And this anchor is so strong that it does not let the ship move. So when a person becomes habitual to something, it overpowers the person. And even if he wants to leave that sin, it becomes difficult for him. It's not easy to leave the bad habits. We can understand the force of bad habits when we try to leave those habits. Why we do sin? There are basically four reasons of that. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has explained all the reasons and He has given the answers of all these reasons in the Quran. First reason of committing the sin is that a person has the feeling that no one is watching at him. No one is looking at him. When someone has the feeling that no one is looking at me, he will commit the sin. You know, if you go to a big department store, there are closer to TV, and everyone knows that I am under surveillance. I am being watched. So no one will make any shoplifting. Because they have the feeling that we are being observed. So when a person has the feeling that no one is looking at me, no one is observing me, no one is watching me, then he commits the sin. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he has explained this reason in Quran. He said, إِنَّ رَبَّكَ لَبِالْمِرْصَادِ. Mirsad is Arabic word which means that if there is a hunter who wants to hit the target, then just few moments before hitting the target, he will keep his breath. He will not blink even the eye. And he will see the target very attentively. That situation of looking the target attentively is called mirqab. إِنَّ رَبَّكَ لَبِالْمِرْقَابِ. O mankind, you are being watched so closely as some hunter is watching his target very attentively. So we are under control for the land. No one can say that no one is looking at me. So the first reason of committing the sin has been answered in Quran. Then the second reason of committing the sin is normally a person has the feeling that no one is with me. Then anyone has the feeling no one is at home. No one was with me. He would like to do nasty things. So this feeling, no one is with me. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given the reason. He has explained. And he told us that whenever you are so, then he is the fifth one. وَهُوَ مَعَكُمْ أَيْنَ مَا كُنْتُمْ. And your Lord, your Creator, he is with you wherever you are. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with us wherever we are. No one can say that no one was with me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is always with us. He is looking at us. One person was going with his son. He passed by a garden and he looked at some grapes. He thought in his mind, let me pick up some grapes and eat. He said to his son, okay, we stand here. Let me go and take some grapes. But if there is someone who is looking at us, then he should tell me. So the small son, he stayed there and the father, he went to pick up the grapes. And suddenly the small son, he started shouting, Ya Abi, Ya Abi, Ahadi, Yawani. Oh my father, oh my dad, someone is looking at us. So this person, he got scared. He came back. But when he looked here and there, he never found anyone. He said, who is looking at us? Then the son answered that, oh my dad, no one from the human being is looking at us, but the creator of the human being, he is looking at us. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is looking at us all the time, and he is with us. So the answer to the second reason has also been given in Quran. Third reason of committing the sin is that person has a feeling that whatever I am doing, no one knows it. The children feel our parents do not know what we do. Husbands feel that the wife does not know what I do. Wife feels husband does not know what I do. So when this is the feeling in the heart that no one knows, this becomes a motivation of committing the sin. I talked to that person on phone, no one knows. I wrote him a letter, no one knows. So this feeling, no one knows. This feeling becomes the root cause of committing the sin. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has explained the answer. That a moment, we cannot have the feeling that no one knows. Our Creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our Lord, He knows everything, whatever we do. Whatever we think in our mind, يَعْلَمُ خَائِنَةَ الْأَعْيُنِ وَمَا تُفِتْتُهُ. He knows even the blinking of your eye and whatever is in your heart. So the emotions, the passions, which are taking place in our heart, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala even knows them. He knows our feelings, our intention. So no one can say that whatever I am doing, no one knows it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows everything. The fourth reason of committing the sin is the feeling that a person says that no one can punish me. For example, the child, he comes to an age, then he feels no one can punish me, no one can save me anything. Even if you want to advise him, you should not do this, he will say, okay, if I do, so what? What you can do? So he feels that no one can say me anything, no one can punish me, no one can do any harm to me. There is no one to check at me. So this feeling, this becomes the motivation of committing this. But then, the answer has been given in Quran. That the person who will commit the sin, he should never think that no one can punish him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so great, in akhdahu aleemun shadeed. He catches the person very forcefully and he punishes him in a very bad manner. So after all, we have to give answer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of judgment. So all these four reasons have been explained and answered in Quran. On the day of judgment, there will be four witnesses against our sin. Number one, our book of deeds. There are two angels. They are writing whatever we are doing, our deeds, good or bad. Inna alaykum lahafizin, kiraman katibin, ya'lamuna ma taqalu. So our file is being prepared. Everything is being documented. So on the day of judgment, we will get our book of deeds. And this will be the first witness. It will be hard copy of our actions in this world. And the criminal person, when he will look at his book of deeds, he will be scared on the day of judgment. And he will say, Mani hazal kitab, la yughadiru saghiratan wala kabiratan illa ahsaha. Wa wajadu ma'amilu hadira, wa la yadlimu rabbuka ahada. What kind of book this is? No sin, minor or major, has been left. Everything has been mentioned there. So whatever we are doing, we will find it in front of us. Complete documentation. This will be our first witness against the sin. Then second witness against the sin will be those angels who are writing. They are also looking. They are witness whatever we are doing. So they will give witness. Oh Allah, he was a pious person. Or oh Allah, he was a bad person. He was a cruel person. So they will be the second witness. And the third witness on the Day of Judgment will be the organs of the body. You know, these organs of the body, they are just the intelligence only. On the Day of Judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give them the power to see. And they will tell Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whatever we have done with these organs. Al-yawm nakhtimu ala afwahihim. وَتُكَلِّمُنَا أَيْدِيهِمْ وَتَشْهَدُ أَرْجُلُهُمْ بِمَا كَانُوا يَكْسِبُونَ. So the mouth will be kept tight shut. And the organs of the body will see. And they will tell, oh, he has been doing this sort of action. وَقَالُوا لِجُلُودِهِمْ لِمَ شَهِدْتُمْ عَلَيْنَا قَالُوا أَنْتَقَنَا اللَّهُ الَّذِي أَنْتَقَ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ. And this person, he will become angry with the organs of the body. And he will say, oh, you are witness against me? I have done everything for your enjoyment. And the organs will say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us the power to speak and we are telling whatever has been done. Fourth witness on the Day of Judgment will be the path of the earth. When we commit sin, we do it on the earth. So that part of the earth, it takes the photograph. It preserves the scene. يَوْمَ إِذٍ تُحَدِّثُ أَخْبَارَهَا بِأَنَّ رَبَّكَ أَوْحَى لَهَا. Quran, Azim al-Shan. That on the Day of Judgment, the earth will release its news. It will say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this person, he prayed on my back, on this place. And this person, he committed sin on this place. So the parts of the earth, they will be different. So if we will commit sin, we cannot escape ourselves from the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One person, he was young, he came to Ibrahim Adam Rahmatullah alayh. And he said, Hazrat, I have a bad habit of committing a sin and I feel I cannot refrain from that sin. But at the same time, I am scared that maybe I will be punished after my death. Is there any way I go on doing the sin as well as I am escaped from the punishment on the Day of Judgment? He might have the mentality like us. Youngster of today. Ibrahim Adam Rahmatullah, he did not push him straight away. These mashayikh, they are very wise people. Very wise people. Wisdom cannot be told. He told him in a very soft way, in a very soft way. Yes. I can tell you few suggestions by which you can commit the sin as well as you can escape yourself. And this person, he became in a receptive mood. He started listening to him very attentively. How did you tell me? He said, my first suggestion is that if you want to commit a sin, you should do it at a place where at least Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cannot see. Now this young man, he said, Hazrat, there cannot be any place where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not see. I cannot find any place. He said, oh, okay. Then I can tell you my second suggestion. Second suggestion is, that this earth and sky is the kingdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's very bad to do something against the rules of the king in his kingdom. So if you want to commit sin, go away from the boundaries of earth and sky and commit the sin. He said, Hazrat, how is it possible? It has been mentioned in Quran, Ya ma'ashar al-jinn wal-ins, in istata'tum أَن تَنْفُذُوا مِنْ أَقْطَارِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ فَانْفُذُوا لَا تَنْفُذُونَ إِلَّا بِسُلْطَانٍ. So we cannot go beyond the limits and boundaries of earth and sky. He said, okay, I give you another suggestion. That if you cannot remain without doing sin, then you should not eat the sustenance given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You will say, oh, I never ate the rizq given by you. And that's why you should not punish me. He said, Hazrat, oh, I can survive without eating and drinking the rizq of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Hazrat told him, okay, I can give you another suggestion. That if you will do so many sins in your life, and then the angel of death will come to you, then you should tell him, wait a minute, please, let me make tawbah, true tawbah. He said, Hazrat, how the angel of death, Israel al Islam, he will wait for me. إِذَا جَاءَ أَجَلُهُمْ فَلَا يَسْتَأْخِرُونَ سَاعَةً وَلَا يَسْتَقْدِمُونَ. When the time will come, it will never be one moment smaller or longer. On the right moment, you will have to go from the square. He said, okay, then I can give you one more suggestion. That when you will go in the grave, and Munkar Nakir, they will come to ask few questions from you, Man Rabbuk, Man Nabiyuk, Ma Deenuk, then you should straight away tell them, go away, why you have come here without my permission? Like we write in our door, no admission without permission. Right of admission reserved. So you should also tell them, why you have come without my permission? He said, yes, I cannot tell them like this. He said, then I have a lot of suggestion. And that is when on the day of judgment, when the book of deeds will be opened in front of you, and it will be filled with the sins and heaps of sins, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will order the angel, take him towards the hell, then you should stand steadfastly and say, oh, I don't want to go to the hell. He said, Hazrat, in front of the angel, oh, I can say I cannot go to the hell. I have nothing in my control. Then he said, I have nothing in my control. Then Hazrat, he found not the iron in his heart, I can hit the iron. He said, okay, if you cannot do anything from all of these suggestions, then why do you disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? He understood the matter. He said, Hazrat, I make a firm commitment from now onwards, I will leave all the sins from my mind. So if we commit the sin, we cannot escape from the punishment. It has to be. One effect of sin is that it keeps the person worried. No matter how successfully some person commits the sin, no matter. There is no one to ask him. There is no one to tell him anything. He is committing the sin successfully. He is enjoying the sin. But the effect of the sin is that his mind, his heart will be perished. He might be millionaire, billionaire. His mind will be perished. It is the effect of the sin. He will have a very soft bed. Noise-free room, but he will not be able to sleep. Worried. I happen to talk to so many rich people. They say we eat whatever we want. We drink whatever we like. We sleep wherever we want. We do everything according to our own ambition, but we don't know why we are worried. It is the effect of the sin. It keeps the person worried. Let me explain it by example. In the hotel, if you go to eat the food, there are buffet systems. So in the buffet system, the food is put in the tray, and then a small candle, a light source, a heat source, is put underneath the tray. Now if you ask someone, that why they have put this heat source under the tray, they will tell, it keeps the food warm for hours and hours. So if we keep this example in our mind, then the example of the sin is just like the heat source. If we will commit it, it will keep us warm all the time. Worried. Huh? All the time under tension and worried. Sometime the wife will become a heat source. Sometime the children will become the heat source. Sometime the business will become the heat source. Sometime his own health will become the heat source. He will get heat from some site. And he will be worried all the time. Worried after worry. And he will say, life is very difficult. You might have the chance to talk to so many people. They are very well off people. They are enjoying every comfort of their life. But at the same time they say, life is very difficult. They have made it difficult with their own hands. Their sins have made the life difficult. So it's the effect of the sin, it makes the man great. The only way to keep the worries away from our mind, from our heart, the solution is that we should leave committing this. We should remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah bi dhikrillahi tatma'innul qulub. And when the remembrance of Allah, we can find the satisfaction of heart. Let me explain it with one example. Let's suppose in Sharia there are 100 sins, bigger sins, kabair. Just to make you understand. So if there are 100 kabair, 100 sins, then there is a distance of 100 steps in between us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whatever sin we will leave, we will become closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we will leave 2 sins, we will come 2 steps to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we leave 3 sins, we will come more closer. And if we will leave 90 sins, we will come more close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then we will leave all the sins, 100%, then we will get the proximity with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The wali of Allah, the friend of Allah, is the person who has left all the sins intentionally from his life. That's the verse which tells us, Udkhulu fi silmi kaffa, that you should enter in Islam right from the hairs of the head up to the toes of the feet. 100% complete. And if we analyze our life, do we refrain from 100% sin? No. Maybe some of us from 90%, 95%, 98%. There will be few percentage of sins which we do in our life. We do it openly sometimes and we do it secretly sometimes. And it is the order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we should leave these sins whatever we do openly or secretly. نَذَرُوا ظَاهِرَ الْإِسْمِ وَبَادِنَا. We feel our neighbor is our enemy. My colleague is my enemy. My friend is my enemy. No. It's not like that. Our nafs and shaitan, they are our biggest enemies. And they are enemies because they motivate us to commit a sin. So if we refrain from sin, then we can make our life a successful life. Once an old person, he was walking through the street, he found some youngsters, they were discussing with each other. When he passed by, one of them said that, "Oh, Sheikh, we are discussing on a topic and we are unable to reach at some result. So can you help us to decide something?" He said, "What?" They said that we are discussing. Few of us, they say, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts a special glance of His mercy of blessing at the heart of a person who has never committed any sin. And the others say, no. The person who was very sinful, who was very bad, who was a sinner, and he made true tawbah. He made firm intention to refrain from sins in future life. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put a special glance of mercy on his heart. Now you tell us, what is the truth? What is the truth? Now this old man, he said, "I'm not a big scholar that I should come up with some logical answer, but I have my own experience that I make cloth and I have very long threads in my machine. But there is one thing, that whenever some thread breaks, then I make a knot in the thread and then I keep an eye on that thread, it may not break again. So maybe a sinner who was committing sins and who has broken his relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but now by making true tawbah, he has made a knot, a relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will have a special glance of mercy on his heart that my servant may not break again." So if we will make true tawbah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be pleased. He likes those people who make true tawbah. No one of us is an angel. We are human beings. We make mistakes. But what is the solution? That if we make mistakes, we should make tawbah. Then and there, we should feel repentance in our heart. It's in a hadith, an-nadmu tawbatun, that the repentance of the heart is the apology, is the tawbah. Hazrat Muslim al-Shafi'i rahmatullah alayh, he wrote a very beautiful point. He said that the verse of Quran is like that, "مَنْ يَعْمَلْ سُوءًا يُجْزَ بِهِ." Whoever will make bad deeds, commit sin, he will get the reward, get the punishment. He said that this is for all, each and everyone. No exemption. مَنْ يَعْمَلْ سُوءًا يُجْزَ بِهِ. Whoever will commit sin, he will get the reward, there will be punishment. Then he explained that what punishment we will get. He wrote that the punishment is that we will be burnt in the fire in lieu of these sins. So the punishment is to be burnt in the fire. But there are two different ways. Number one, if the person, he feels repentance on his sin, so this repentance, this nadamat, is just like a fire, internal fire. It's the fire in the heart. He is feeling unrest, uneasy. He wants to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why this person, he will cry, he will make dua, he will make tahajjud, he will recite the Quran and he will try to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It means his heart is burning in the fire of repentance.
So he said there are two ways. One is that our hearts should be burned with the fire of repentance in this world, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive us in the hereafter. And if we will not make true tawbah, and we will not feel repentance on our sins, then we will be burnt in the flame of fire of hell on the day of judgment. So what is the easy route? It's better to feel repentance on the sins in this world. Ask forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We should try to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with our good deeds. Nafs and shaitan, they are our biggest enemies. They are always behind us and they are pushing us to commit the sin. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He orders us that we should refrain from sin, whether we do it openly or secretly. And there is a verse in Quran. وَلَا يَحِيقُ الْمَكْرُ السَّيِّئُ إِلَّا بِأَهْلِ. Please try to understand this verse. That if we will have bad ambitions about others, then they will have bad ambitions about us. Yes. Tit for tat. Whatever we'll do, we will get the same reaction. Let me explain with an example. There was a jeweler. One day he came to have lunch at his home and he found that his wife, she was crying bitterly. She asked her, "Why you are crying?" His wife was very beautiful and very pious lady, and she was crying. He asked her, "What happened to you?" She said, "Look at this servant. He was a small kid 10 years ago. When he came in our house, I took care of him just like my son. Now he is adult. Today when he came and he wanted to give groceries to me, then he held my hand, and I feel that he held my hand with love. So I'm crying. How we can depend on anyone? I brought him up just like my son. It's 10 years. He is there. But today he did this. So that's why I'm crying." So when this jeweler, he listened to this, he also started crying. Now the wife asked him, "Why you are crying?" He said, "It's not the mistake of the servant, it's my mistake." She said, "Oh." He said that today, some lady came to purchase some bangle, and then she wanted help. She wanted to put the bangle on the arm. And when I looked at her arm, I liked, they were very beautiful. I held her arm with love. Because I held the arm of that lady with love, now my servant held the arm of my wife. Whatever we will do, we will get the response. What these youngsters feel? If they will have bad glances towards the daughters of other people, people will not have the same glances towards their sister, their wife, their mother. مَنْ يَعْمَلْ سُوءًا يُجْزَ بِهِ وَلَا يَحِيقُ الْمَكْرُ السَّيِّئُ إِلَّا بِأَهْلِهِ. Yes. If we will have bad ambitions about other Muslim brothers, then they will have the same ambitions about our family. And it's in one of the hadith that you should become well-wisher of the families of others, and others will become the well-wisher of your family. So we have to leave the sin. if we want to have a successful life. There's no way out. So we should make true tawbah. And then Allah Ta'ala, He likes the person who makes true tawbah. He loves the person. And if he becomes happy, that the person is really confessing his crime and he is asking forgiveness, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala changes the sins into the virtues of did a sin, then we should make true tawbah and these sins will be erased from our book of deeds. And if we will be more sincere and will do it sincerely, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will change the sins into the virtues of a person. So by the help of tawbah, we can make our minus into plus. We can change it. The ball is in our court. And this is that if we ask forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is very great. He loves the person who asks forgiveness from Him. That's why there is a verse in Quran, نَبِّ عِبَادِي أَنِّيَنَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمِ. He is so merciful. So in this sitting, we should have a firm commitment in our heart that we should leave all the sins, whatever we do in our life. We should try, we should struggle. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will help us. It's difficult for us. But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will help us, then nothing will be difficult. Our hearts are in His control. He will change the direction of the heart. And if we feel that there is a big problem, we have tried again and again, and it has not worked, then we should try to consult some spiritual doctor. Like if some person is not feeling well, he is sick, he goes to the physician, he consults the physician, gets the prescription. Similarly, the person who wants to leave the sin, but he cannot. He has made so many attempts, but he never succeeded. Then the way is that he should contact the Messiah, the scholar. He should tell them. And then they will suggest him, in the light of Quran and Sunnah, what he has to do. Like our medicine, this is antibiotic, this is this syrup and this. Similarly, there is an Sharia, zikr. Rasulullah ﷺ told us, zikrullah is shifa'ul qulub. That the remembrance of Allah is the remedy for all the diseases of the heart. The recitation of Quran is itself the remedy for our sins. To pray, to make proper prayer is also the remedy. So the Messiah, they will tell. They will tell us how we can get rid of these sins. One young man, he went to a big scholar and said, Hazrat, I am a businessman and the customers, they come to me. There are gents and ladies. I can't keep control of my eyes. It's very difficult for me. What should I do? He suggested him and told him that it's a big sin.
you should try to keep control. We have been ordered by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغُضُّوا مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ. He said, but I am young, so I can control myself. He said, you can. He said, but I feel there is no way. Now this big scholar, he said that, okay, you do one job for me and then I will tell you how to leave this sin. He said, okay, I can do any work for you. He said, okay, take this glass of milk and give it to the person who is living on the other side of this market. But there is one condition. He has to pass through the market and I will send one person with you and he will watch you. And if any drop from the glass, it fell on the ground, then this person, he will finish you then and there, in front of the people. He said, okay, let me try. No, he held the glass in his hand, filled with the milk, and then he started walking towards the milk. Now, throughout the way, he was attentive towards his glass, his hand, and then he reached his destination and gave the glass of milk to the person, to the prophet. And he came back and he said, Hazrat, I did the job. I was successful. Now Hazrat asked him, okay, tell me, how many faces you have seen with bad glances? He said, Hazrat, I even did not have the time to look towards anyone. I was attentive towards this glass because I had a fear that if any drop will fall down, this person who is with me will punish me in front of the people. Then the chef told him that a moment he had the same condition in his heart, that my heart, the glass of heart is filled with the milk of Iman and I have to pass through the market of this world. And if I will become forgetful, become ghafil, then maybe this milk can fall down. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make me ashamed in front of all the human beings on the day of judgment. So that's why they don't look here and there. They keep tight control on their glance. Leave all the sins, whatever you do openly or you do secret. So that's the only solution. Hafiz ibn Qayyim rahmatullah alayh. But there is the way how we should make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We should spend some time in privacy in the day or in the night. Just few minutes. Maybe after the Isha, maybe before Fajr. In loneliness. And we should try to communicate with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then make dua. With the help of this dua, we will start receiving the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Dua has a big power. Very powerful thing. But the main problem is that we don't make dua, we read dua. There is a difference in making the dua and in reading the dua. We have the habit of reading the dua. For example, we finish our prayer and then we start reading the dua. Rabbana, 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 Rabbana. And at the end of the dua, we even do not know what dua we have made. So this is reading the dua. It's not dua, it's reading the dua. To make dua is that the person who is attentive and he is just like a dagger in front of a very rich person. Have you ever seen the dagger? He wants to get one rupee. And then he will make his hand, the shape will be as if he is a very deserving person. He reviewed the world. He is a very deserving person. And then he will have the glory as if he is a very deserving person. Everything, right from here up to the toe, he will try to prove that he is a very deserving person. To get one rupee, he makes like that. And if he has to seek the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, oh, we should make dua. We should make dua like that. Oh Allah, we have committed sin. I confess, I was wrong. But now I have realized. Oh my Lord, don't take me away from your day. Accept my dua. I want to become a good person. But alone I cannot do anything. I need your help. So Allah, help me against my nafs and my shaitan. And when we make dua like this, then Allah SWT will accept our dua. Hafiz ibn Kathir rahmatullah alayh, he wrote a story. He said that once I was passing through a street, suddenly the door of the house was opened, and I found that there was a small kid, maybe of 7-8 years, and his mother, she was mad at him. And she was shouting at him. And she was pushing him away from the house. And she was saying, you don't listen to me. And you are so stubborn. And you are disobedient. If you don't want to listen to me, go away from my house. I don't want to see your ugly face. She said the word and she pushed her away until she fell down in the street. She closed the door. He said, I stood there, what's happening? Now this small son, this small kid, he was crying. Now after some time, he stood up and he started going on one side of the street. When he reached at the corner of the street, he stood there as if he was still thinking about something. And then he started coming back slowly, slowly. When he reached his door, he sat there because he was very much exhausted and he was crying, so he slept there. He said after some time, his mother again opened the door. She wanted to come out to do some job. And when she looked that the son is still on the doorstep, she was still very angry. She again started shouting at him, why don't you go away? Now this small son, he stood up and then he started crying. He said, oh my mom, can you push me away from your house? Initially I thought I should go away. Mom, I thought I should go, I will get some person in the market and I will have something to eat. I thought I should go away. I will become servant to someone and he will give me something to eat. I thought I should go away. I will clean the shoes of some people and they will give me something to eat. Mom, yes, I took the step. I went until the corner of the street. But then I realized, Mom, I will get everything to eat and drink. But whatever love you can give to me, no one in the world can give it to me. So then I thought, Mom, I came back. I'm on this door. You push me away, or you take me to this home. I'm your son. I cannot go away. Whatever love you can give to me, no one else in this world can give it to me. Now these words, they melted the heart of the mom. And then he embraced the son and hugged the son and said, oh my son, if you have the feeling, what love I can give to you, no one in the world can give it to you. My doors are wide open. Come and stay with me. He wrote the story and he said that when a sinner comes at the door of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, comes in the masjid, in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then he cries, and then he asks forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he says that, oh Allah, whatever mercy you can give to me, there is no one else who can give it to me. You are my only Lord. Oh Allah, there are billions and billions of your servants, your human beings. But there is no other Lord what I have. You are only one. So I have to ask forgiveness from you.
Ilahi abduka al-afiyataka mukirram bidh-dhunubi wa qaddaaka. Get to Allah, your sinner is on your doorstep. I confess my sin. And then I make dua. فَإِن تَغْفِرْ فَأَنْتَ لِسَاكَ أَحْلٌ وَإِن تَطْرُدْ فَمَنْ يَرْحَمْ سِوَاكَ. Oh Allah, if you forgive me, it is according to your greatness. And if you push me away, oh Allah, is there any other one who can embrace me? So if there is no one else who can embrace me, there is only one God. Oh Allah, you forgive me, open the door. I have come here to ask forgiveness from you. So then we will make two tawbah like this. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He will accept our tawbah, our dua, and He will forgive the sins, and He will help us in our future life to refrain from sin. So that was the topic of today. وَذَرُوا ظَاهِرَ الْإِثْمِ وَبَاطِنَا. Leave all the sins, whatever you do, openly or secretly. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to refrain from all the sins and to lead a virtuous life, a good life, and to become a pious person, and to have a good, to be a good person of the society. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should forgive all the sins, our blunders, whatever we have committed in our previous life. And in future, we should be attentive. Because these sins, they are a burden on our head. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين. Before making dua, we can just sit down just for a few minutes and we can make zikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with our heart. We can remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in our heart so that we should analyze ourselves. We should put a glance on our previous life and then we should make dua. So please just for a few minutes, you can be attentive towards your heart. You should feel as if some mercy, some rahmat, blessing is coming from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in our heart, and the darkness of the heart is going away and our heart is saying Allah, Allah, Allah. Those are verses of Quran. وَذْكُرْ رَبَّكَ فِي نَفْسِكَ أي فِي قَلْبِكَ. That you should remember your Lord in your heart.
اپنے من میں ڈوب کر ساجا سراغِ زندگی تو اگر میرا نہیں بنتا نہ بن اپنا تو بن من کی دنیا من کی دنیا تو جو مستی جذب و شوق تن کی دنیا تن کی دنیا سود و سودا مکر و فن من کی دولت ہاتھ آتی ہے تو پھر جاتی نہیں تن کی دولت چھاؤں ہے آتا ہے دھن جاتا ہے دھن پانی پانی کر گئی مجھ کو پلندر کی یہ بات تو جھکا جب غیر کے آگے نہ تن تیرا نہ من تو جھکا جب نفس کے آگے نہ تن تیرا نہ من لا إله إلا الله دعا في بيت الحمد رب العالمين اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وبارك لنا ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب ہم مالک ہم آپ کے متعدد یقین بندے ہیں ہمارے گناہوں کو معاف فرما ہماری خطاؤں کو درگزر فرما ہمارے عیبوں کی سردہ پوشی فرما اے اللہ ہماری نگاہوں کو پاک فرما ہمارے دلوں کو صاف فرما ہمارے سینوں کو اپنی محبت سے لبریز فرما اپنے عشق ہمارے سینوں میں پیدا فرما ہمارے انگن کے اپنے ذکر کو جاری فرما روئے روئے کے اپنے ذکر کو جاری فرما ہماری سبھی ہڈی بوسی بوسی میں اپنی محبت پیدا فرما اے اللہ ہمارے علم میں برکت پیدا فرما عمل میں برکت پیدا فرما رزق میں برکت پیدا فرما صحت میں برکت پیدا فرما حفظ میں برکت پیدا فرما کاموں میں برکت پیدا فرما ہمارے فیصلوں میں برکت پیدا فرما قدم قدم اپنی برکتیں شامل حال فرما اے اللہ ہمیں برے دل سے محفوظ فرما بری رات سے محفوظ فرما اللہ برے کاموں سے محفوظ فرما برے دوستوں سے محفوظ فرما بری محفلوں سے محفوظ فرما اللہ نے برے انجام سے محفوظ فرما اے اللہ ہدایت کے بعد گمراہی سے محفوظ فرما اپنے قرب کے بعد دوری سے محفوظ فرما اللہ ہمیں عزت ملنے کے بعد خدمت سے محفوظ فرما اللہ حاصلوں کے حسد سے محفوظ فرما دشمنوں کی دشمنی سے محفوظ فرما برا چاہنے والوں کی برائی سے محفوظ فرما نفر شیطان کے مکر و فریب سے محفوظ فرما رب کریم ہمارے ساتھ رحمت کا معاملہ فرما اے اللہ نیک مقاصد میں کامیابی عطا فرما ہمارے اچھے یہ کاموں کا ہونا آسان فرما اللہ ہمارے ان بے کاموں کو اپنی رحمت سے سلجا اللہ ہمارے ساتھ درگزر کا معاملہ فرما اے اللہ ہم سے تو دھوپ کی گرمی برداشت نہیں ہوتی تیرے جہنم کی گرمی کہاں برداشت ہوگی اللہ ہمارے ساتھ درگزر کا معاملہ فرما اے مالک دنیا میں آپ نے ایسی نعمتوں کے ساتھ ہمیں پالا کہ پروردگار آخرت کی نعمتوں سے محروم نہ کرنا رب کریم ہمارے ساتھ رحمت کا معاملہ کرنا اے اللہ ہم اپنے گناہوں کے نادے مرد شرمندہ ہیں میرے مالک آج کی محفل میں سب کی توبہ کرتے ہیں اے اللہ آئندہ آنے والے وقت کو برے وقت سے بہتر فرما آنے والی زندگی کو گزری زندگی کا کفارہ بنا اللہ ہمیں آئندہ گناہوں کی سچنے کی توفیق نصیب فرما نیکوکاری کی زندگی نصیب فرما پرہیزگاری کی زندگی نصیب فرما اے اللہ جن لوگوں کے ہمارے اوپر حقوق آتے ہیں زندہ ہیں یا فوت ہو چکے اے اللہ ان کو بھی ان دعاؤں میں حصہ نصیب فرما اور اس کے بدلے قیامت کے دن ان کے حقوق سے ہمیں سبق گوش فرما اے اللہ ہمارے والدین عزیز اقارب نصائح کی دنیا سے رخصت ہو چکے ان کو بھی ان دعاؤں میں حصہ نصیب فرما ان کی مغفرت فرما اور قرب کے اعلیٰ درجات عطا فرما اے اللہ دلوں کی جو بھی پریشانیاں ہیں دور فرما اے اللہ آپ دلوں کے بھید جاننے والے ہیں اللہ آپ کے بندے اور آپ کی بندیاں آپ کے سامنے ہاتھ پھیلائے بیٹھے ہیں رب کریم رحمت کا معاملہ فرما اللہ چل کے آئے ہوئے لوگ آدمی کا تو لوگ بھی دنیا دار کی لحاظ کر لیتے ہیں اے مالک ہی آپ کے در پہ چل کے آئے ہیں آپ کی لحاظ فرما دیجئے اللہ گناہوں کو معاف فرما دیجئے خطاؤں سے درگزر فرما دیجئے اے مالک ہم بھولے رہے اللہ جب بچہ پریشان ہوتا ہے ماں باپ کی طرف دوڑتا ہے جب بندے پریشان ہوتے ہیں اپنے رب کی طرف لوٹتے ہیں ایسے خطوں کے دستگیر ایسے دلوں کو تسلی دینے والے اے کالی گولیوں کو بھر دینے والے اے زخمی دلوں کو مرہم رکھ دینے والے اے خطا کاروں کی خطاؤں پہ رحمت کی چادر ڈال دینے والے پروردگار ہمارے اوپر بھی رحمت کی نظر فرما اے اللہ ہمیں آئندہ نیکوکاری کی زندگی نصیب فرما رب کریم جب کوئی ماں اپنے بچے کو نجاست میں نکلا ہوا دیکھتی ہے وہ بچے کو پھینک نہیں دیتی نفرت نہیں کرتی سمجھتی ہے نادان ہے مگر بیٹا تو میرا ہی ہے وہ بچے کو صاف کر لیتی ہے پھر سینے سے لگا لیتی ہے اللہ ہم بھی گناہوں کی نجاست میں نکلے پڑے ہیں مگر بندے تو آ چکے ہیں اے اللہ نفرت نہ فرمائیے
ہمیں اپنی نگاہوں سے گرا نہ دیجیے، اللہ ہمیں اپنے در سے جھٹکے نہ دے دیجیے، رب کریم ہماری گاؤں کو پھٹے کپڑے کی طرح منہ پہ نہ مار دیجیے، اللہ ہم آپ کے بندے ہیں، ہمیں اپنی رحمت کی نظر عطا کر دیجیے اور گناہوں کی نجاست سے دھو کر رحمت کی چادر میں چھپا لیجیے۔ میرے مولا رحمت کا معاملہ فرما، کرم کا معاملہ فرما، اے اللہ ہماری ان دعاؤں کو اپنی رحمت سے قبول فرما، اے اللہ جو اولاد نرینہ کے طلبگار ہیں ان کو اولاد نرینہ نصیب فرما، جو صاحب اولاد ہیں ان کی اولادوں کو نیکوکار بنا، فرما بردار بنا، ماں باپ کی آنکھوں کی ٹھنڈک بنا، جن گھروں میں جوان بچے بچیاں موجود ہیں اے اللہ ان بچوں کو مستقبل کو روشن فرما، ماں باپ کے لیے ان کے فرض ادا کرنے آسان فرما، اے اللہ اولاد کے غموں سے محفوظ فرما، اولاد کے دکھوں سے محفوظ فرما، اولاد کی پریشانیوں سے محفوظ فرما، اے مالک ہم اپنے بچوں کو پڑھنے کے لیے کاموں کے لیے گھروں سے بھیج دیتے ہیں، اللہ ہم دور ہوتے ہیں آپ قریب ہوتے ہیں، اے مالک گناہوں سے ان کی حفاظت فرما، برے لوگوں سے ان کی حفاظت فرما، انسانوں کی شکل میں جو شیطان ہے اللہ ان سے ان کی حفاظت فرما، رب کریم قیامت تک آنے والے نسلوں سے ایمان کی حفاظت فرما، رب کریم ہماری دعاؤں کو اپنی رحمت سے قبول فرما، رب کریم ہم نے جو بھی اب تک گناہ کیے ان کو معاف فرما، تو پھر جو تجھے فتنے کا حوال کیے ان کو سر سے قبولیت نصیب فرما، اے اللہ ہمیں نماز کی حضوری نصیب فرما، سجدے کا سرور نصیب فرما، قرآن پاک پڑھنے کا لطف نصیب فرما، رات کے آخری پہر کی مناجات کی لذت نصیب فرما، اے اللہ ہمیں ایمان حقیقی کی حلاوت نصیب فرما، رب کریم ہم چاہے نہ چاہیں انسانی کے بالوں سے پکڑ کر ہمیں نیک بننے کی توفیق عطا فرما، ربنا تقبل منا انک انت السائل، امت مسلمہ کو عزت رکھنا نصیب فرما، پوری دنیا میں جہاں جہاں مسلمان پریشان ہیں اے اللہ ان کی پریشانیوں کو دور فرما، اللہ ہمیں ایک بنا اور نیک بنا، حقوق اللہ اور حقوق العباد دونوں کو پورا کرنے کی توفیق نصیب فرما، صلی اللہ تعالی علی حبیبہ سیدنا محمد و آلہ و اصحابہ اجمعین برحمتک یا ارحم الراحمین۔